I'd like to show you some samples of the apparatus from my collection. This is known as the Inzani Henley flyover cage. It utilizes three blocks, red, blue, and yellow. They go onto the little stand here, and we also have an empty tube. The tube is placed over the top, like so, and the whole thing is left on the stand. Over here we have a bird cage. The bird looks as though it's deceased, but don't worry about that. We have a small box. The bird cage goes into the box. Lid placed on, and now we start the transposition. Snap of the fingers, bird cage goes up in the air and travels from the tube over to the box. One empty tube. Let's have a look in the box. Seems to have arrived. There's the solid block, having travelled from there. Okay, now perhaps you'd like to know how this trick works. It actually uses a metal shell. The metal shell is the blue one, and it fits over the bird cage like so. By twisting the block slightly, the metal shell will stay in position. When the tube is placed over the top, what actually happens is there's a small recess in the bottom of the tube, and this metal shell lodges in the recess. So, as it's placed over, the metal shell is now lodged in the recess of the tube. When it's lifted off, when it's lifted off, there is the metal shell in the end of the tube, and the bird cage has appeared. What about the box? Well, the box is not quite as innocent as it appears. The blue block is in one side of the box, but it's a double-ended box, and the bird cage does in fact have a sliding floor, so that when it's placed into the box, the floor moves up and allows the cage to go in. As you place it on the table, you simply reverse the ends, taking off the duplicate lid, and out comes your solid block. That's the Inzani Henley flyover cage. Hi, here's another piece from my collection. Essentially, this is one of only two ever made by Joseph Bland & Company in London. The idea is you open the front, open the lid, open the second lid, no mirrors, close the whole thing up again, close the door, close the lid, strange thing happens. You got a brick. And it really is a brick. Okay, I suppose you want to know how it works. Well, it's a very, very clever mechanism. Essentially, it all works from the lid itself. When you open this top lid, automatically the brick is brought out at the back by a system of levers. It follows then that you can show the box empty by opening the front door and opening the lids. Close the lids up, close the front up, and then automatically, as you close the top lid, your brick is loaded into the box and you make your production. Joseph Bland, trick with a brick. Here's another item from the collection. This is the Rubik Cube trick. Essentially, I bought one of these many years ago and I tried moving it around, but I really couldn't make the thing work. Far too clever for me. So I devised an idea whereby we could do it by magic. Simply take a box, drop the Rubik Cube in, place on the lid, say the magic words. Take the lid off, take the Rubik cube out, and now it's completely solved on every side. And it really is just a normal Rubik cube. Well, I suppose you'd like to know how the trick works. It's very, very clever. You require a metal shell. Actually, two metal shells, so that the Rubik cube is actually split. The reason it's split is simple. You need to be able to show that it does turn. If you didn't split the shell, then of course it wouldn't be as clever. But it allows you to turn the Rubik cube, ensuring of course that you turn it four times, otherwise you finish up with mismatched colours. Take the cube then, place it into the bottom of the box. Take the lid, place that on top. There's a magnet in the top, magnet in the bottom. Now when you remove the lid, you can't see the half shell, nor can you see the half shell there, but you do have a completely solved Rubik cube.
Hi, I'm Russ Stevens and welcome to this unique DVD. For the first time, I'm going to take you into a world that's unknown to most magicians, a place where you can work on some of the finest stages, eat some of the finest food, and above all, make a fantastic living. Welcome to Magic's Biggest Secret.
Amazing. Amazing.
Hi, I'm Martin Sanderson, and welcome to Corporate Close Up. And this is what I do.
Check it out. Check it.
Can you put your signature on the two of diamonds in big letters? Big, big letters. That's cool. That's it. It's a pen. No more clues.
Come and write on
yes,
your
please.
Card.
Yeah. Put your phone number. Thank you. Oh, just your name. That'd be cool. And space for this man's credit card numbers as well.
It's probably disappearing ink there later.
A. Yeah.
R.
Do you want a question on sport instead? It's entirely your choice. Cool. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now, say you get a glass of champagne for helping me. Thank you. But it gets better. Now, check this out. I'm going to squeeze it in the deck. When I do this, the card will visibly jump to the top of the deck, but you'll never see it happen. It happens that quick. This is such a cool trick. I'm going to take it here, squeeze it in, a little move like this, and it comes back to the top. Now, I'll do it again at fingertips. I'll do it again, real slow. We do this.
Yes.
Little spin, squeeze it in, twice as quick, back to the top. But I'll do it again real soon. I'm going to teach you how this works. You see, when I do the funny move, I get eye contact and you miss the move. So I do this, I sneak it from here over to here, but it doesn't explain how it gets over here. But it gets better than this. I'm going to make it travel all the way from here over to here and the blink of an eye. So can you just push the card in?
Look at his mouth.
Well, that was 45 seconds, world record. Well done you. I have a fabulous souvenir. I got this from a man I met a few moments ago. You! I got this from this young man. I got his wallet. Fantastic. Special souvenir. This is for you. This is from Anne, who's holding a party today. This is for you. It's the bill for this afternoon. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Can
you check it out? Sarah, you're going to love this. What a great trick. You're never going to believe it, Sarah. It's such a cool trick. Trust me. The bill for this afternoon, very expensive. Well, I never. But you know what? It gets better than this. I'm going to show you. Can you hold on to the envelope, Sarah? I'm going to teach you how the trick works. In fact, you can see through the trick. Young man, can you just give me a hand? What's your name?
Matthew.
Are you married?
No.
Cool. Matthew, hold your hand out like this, Matthew. We do this. Can you just wave the envelope over the deck?
Sorry.
Just wave it over the deck. Watch. Just keep it here. Watch as we do this. And this. And this. Watch.
My name's Arthur Casson, and I'm the president of Blackpool Magicians Club. Welcome to this DVD. I do hope you'll enjoy it. It's been compiled by the club with material from many, many of our friends throughout the world of magic, and we thank them for it. But we have some very, very talented members in our club, and we'd like to introduce some of them to you. But first of all, here's my little favourite trick. This box is over 100 years old, and when we open this compartment here, well, you see that there's a die there. But if we tap the box, it's gone. Tap it twice. And it's back again, by magic. Tap it three times, and it gets a bit boring. So, let's have a cup of tea. One lump or two.
Hi, my name's Les Pybus. Did you know that in the early part of the 19th century, a guy by the name of Anton Mesmer had the word mesmerism named after him? Nowadays, of course, we would know that as hypnosis. And one of the induction techniques that Mesmer would be to use a swinging pendulum from a watch on a chain, or in this case, a ring and a string. And what Mesmer would do would be he would make sure that the client was watching and then move the pendulum from side to side, forward and backwards. And when they displayed certain hypnotic phenomena, he would test whether in fact they were under and if they still thought that the ring was on the string. He could test them even further by taking the two ends, taking the ring and massaging the ring back on the string in this fashion, thereby proving they were going deeper and deeper into trance. From now on, of course, anything went. Whether you got into a deeper state of somnambulism, of course, Mesmer could do anything with them at all. The final test, of course, was to prove, in fact, that they were hallucinating, even if they thought that in the first place he was using a ring at all. Or, in fact, if they were using a pendulum at all. Oh, by the way, in a moment, you'll wake up when I snap my fingers, you'll feel fully refreshed, and you'll never smoke again. Bye.
Hello there. My name is Norman, Norman Langfield. If I had to show you now a little trick, very, very old trick, three shells and a pea. There's a little pea and the shell. Now, the idea is this one, you keep the eye on the pea. Put it over there, little shell there, little shell there. We're out of the way. We all know where the pea is, under the shell. I'll do it again for you. There, little pea, one shell, two shells. Prepare the way, one, two, and three. I'll move it out of the way, because we're all know where the pea is, under the shell. That's showing our little variation. Put the pea down and the shell, hide it with the cup. Now we all know where the pea is, it's under the cup. You didn't see it go, did you? Thank you.
La verdad que no es fácil. David and Daniel.
Ya volvemos con el ilusionismo fantástico de Eric Logan y las cartas mágicas de Peter Marvin.
David und Daniel, USA.
David und Daniel.
Today on Salad, we'll take your breath away.
You know how men are always complaining women don't change their clothes fast enough? Now, we have a woman and a man who can really change clothes fast. Television, you're saying to yourself, they made very good cuts, I have to tell you. Right, audience? Was all done in real time.
Son un matrimonio. Ella es rusa y él es norteamericano. De seguro nos traen un espectáculo que nos va a impactar. Han mezclado la danza con la magia. Y quiero dejar en este escenario, porque han llegado desde directamente a la Quinta Vergara, David and Dania.
Hi, I'm Russ Brown. I've been asked by Blackpool Magicians Club to come down to the club room tonight and do just one of my favourite tricks, and this is it. It's a really, really quick trick. It uses four cards. Whatever four cards we're going to cut to are the four cards we're going to use. In fact, they're these ones. That's one, that's two, that's three, that's four aces. Now we've got the four aces, we can do the trick. Now, it's a bit of a strange trick. In fact, it's a typical magician's type thing. After actually bothering to find the aces, I'm going to take them all, put them back inside the pack, and then find them all again. Which sort of asks the question, what's the point? But anyway, they do all go in at different parts of the pack. The ace of spades goes down there, that one goes there, diamonds goes there, clubs there. They are all in different parts of the pack all the way through, and the idea is now that we've got to find them. Now, the first ace is the easiest. The first one's dead easy to get. All we've got to do to get the first ace is this. We take the cards, I'm going to cut them about there. Once we cut them there, one card jumps out the centre of the pack like this one, and that's the first one. The ace of spades. The second one is a little bit more difficult. Okay, to get the second one, all we're going to do is shuffle the cards. After we shuffle them, we flick like this. One card jumps up to the top, and it's this one, the second ace, which is cleverly disguised as a nine. You're not taking that in, are you? Watch, we take the nine and we do this, this, and this, and it turns into ace number two, that's ace of hearts. Okay, ace number three. Ace number three is probably the fastest of the lot. To get ace number three, we turn over the top card, what is it, the jack of clubs, and we do this, it comes back down as the ace of clubs. There's only one left, the Ace of Diamonds. Now, this is the most difficult one to get, and it's a bit of a bizarre one, this, because you've all heard of Alibaba and the 40 Thieves. This is something very, very similar, except it's Russ Brown and 49 cards. You take the cards and you shout, "Open Sesame." Once you do that, the cards open up. You reach in at the centre of the pack, you pull one card out of the middle, and it's the final one, the Ace of Diamonds.
Abra's here again. Whenever it comes, it's always full of magical tricks, as you know, but where he gets the moth from, I've no idea. Maybe it's time that we got rid of them. Oh, well. I'll show you a small little trick over here with a matchbox, okay? It's a thing you can see all the way through here, you can see on top of there. One, two, a little bit of magic, rub the back of your hand like this and the draw comes out, okay? Close it up, turn it over, place it on your hand. The magic word is stand up, please. The draw comes up. Talking of matches, of course, sometimes matches can be easily vanished. You can hear the matches. We'll make the matches vanish. Oh, it's the case. The matches are still here. Kenbrook, a very favourite magician of mine for many years, used to demo a little trick all over the UK. It's with a pencil. The pencil goes on your hand, you ask the pencil to move forward, it'll move forward. Let's go to the side, it'll go to the side. The animated pencil, placed down in your hand, will rise up. And if you take the pencil and a bottle, and a little bit of la da dee da dum, da da dee da dee da dee. Da 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 da. In memory of Kenbrook. Thank you very much.
Dancing box. Little box dances. What actually works it? Is this little fly. And there's nothing else in the box. I do actually tell lies.
So it isn't the fly.
It's not the fly. The fly's dead.
amazing.
Hello there and welcome to Blackpool Magic Club. My name is Magic Malky and I'm one of the newest members here at the club. And hopefully you enjoy my little effect. What it is we've got here is a pack of cards like so, that are all different that side, and also they're all different the other side as well. What we shall do with the pack of cards, we shall put my finger in the pack and watch what we find. We find a card which is the Nine of Spades. We put the Nine of Spades in the pack like so, so everyone can see it. We close it back up like so, like that, and we go 1, 2, 3, woof, and the Nine of Spades jumps to the top. Now what we'll do with the Nine of Spades now, we put the Nine of Spades back onto the top of the pack. We shall half the pack like so, and we go woof, and watch very carefully. It jumps back to the top. Now what we'll do with the Nine of Spades this time, we shall lose it in the pack like so. And now what we'll do, we shall put my finger in the pack anywhere. Stop! There we go. And watch what you find is the Nine of Spades. Now what we'll do with the Nine of Spades this time, we'll put the Nine of Spades in there, like so. And we've got a card here at the top, which is the Nine of Hearts. The Nine of Hearts now goes on the top of the table. The Nine of Spades is there. We'll put my hand down there, like so. And we'll go like that, right through my hand, and watch by magic, we've got the Nine of Hearts there, the Nine of Spades there. And for the final part of the trick, we'll put the Nine of Spades back on the top of the deck, we shall half the pack like so, and watch very carefully, the Nine of Spades jumps to the top of the pack. I hope you've enjoyed my little effect, and I hopefully you enjoy the rest of the DVD. Thank you very much.
My name's David Plant, I've just come back from Las Vegas. While I was there, I was walking down the strip. This guy came up to me and said, Dave, you're the guy that owes me $8. I said, no problem, I've got the $8. 1, 2, 3, 4. He said, Dave, it was $8, not 4. I said, there's 1, there's 2, there's 3, there's 4, 5, there's 6, there's 7, there's 8. He said, 8, Dave, you're counting $4 as 8. You're counting the front and the backs as 8. I said, no. He said, what's 1 and 1? That's 2. There's $2. 2 and 2 plus 1 is 5. There's 5. He said, 8. There's 5 plus 2 plus 1. There's your $8. I call that $10 interest. Thanks very much.
Hi, my name's Jeremy. I went to the opticians this morning and I was in for a bit of a surprise because the optician said to me, we're not using eye charts to test your eyes anymore. We're going to use playing cards. And I said, well, how does it work? He said, it's very simple. We're going to use the four queens from a deck of cards. I said, very good. I said, what do you do? He said, very simple. He said, you have to tell me which one of the four queens was face down. I said, none of them, they were all facing the right way. He said, well, your eyes are very bad, sir. Had you have been looking very carefully, you would have in fact noticed that the club had turned face down. I said, I didn't see that. He says, very funny. He says, some people actually think that the heart turns face down. He says, people who are colourblind get hearts confused with spades and think that the spades turn face down. And the remaining 10 or 15% of people actually think that it's the diamond that turns face down. He said, but I'll let you into a little secret. I said, what's that? He said, well, actually, you were right. All the cards are, in fact, facing the right way. I said, you're cheating me. He said, I'm not. He said, what colour were the backs of the cards? I said, they were red. Oh, he said, actually, you're colourblind, sir. Had you been looking very carefully, you would have, in fact, noticed that the backs of the cards are, in fact, all blue. I said, you're cheating. He said, I'm not. He said, what's your vision retention like? I said, I don't understand. He said, well, if I was to take this card and place it into my pocket, how many cards would I have left? Simple, you'd have 3. I said, you're not watching very carefully, sir. Had you been watching, you would have in fact noticed that I do have in fact have the four queens. I said, no, you are cheating. He said, I'm not. He said, when did you last have your eyes tested? I said, about 4 years ago. He said, what did he use to test your eyes with? He said, well, in them charts on the wall with the little letters. Oh, he said, you mean one of them, sir? I said, yeah, that's right. He said, well, actually, your eyes are so bad, I think you need 1, 2, 3, 4, and I get my glasses next week. Thank you.
Hey. 飛行のマジックを見せます。赤い箱があります。中に黄色いシルクが1枚入ってます。もちろん赤が入ってます。保育園です。さあ、この1枚のシルクを
世の中に入れます。そしてこれが消えてこの箱に飛んでいくという、こういうすごい飛行マジックです。いきます。はい、飛行しました。でも我々宇宙の町になりますと、ただ飛ぶだけで面白くて、これがまた帰ってくる。こういうのあ、ダメ。じゃあ今度は本当に飛行します。シルクを見せます。いきます。ワン、ツー、スリーと、もちろん消えて飛行します。もう一回、じゃあ分かりました。だからもうです、違いかを開けますと、中からというフェーズが変化技です。まあもちろん同じような感じを、宇宙に吸いてきます。消えたら、なんと、それぞれハンカチが入ってます。まず青いハンカチ、ちょっと持ってないです。はい、この中にはいろんなハンカチが入ってます。赤いハンカチ、はい、緑のハンカチ、そして最後の箱には黄色いハンカチが入ってます。さあ、4枚のハンカチが出ました。こちらに持ってきました。赤い袋の中、これはもちろん何もやろう、それ言いますが、一 1枚ずつこの袋の中に入れていただきます。どれからでも結構です。1枚ずつ入れましょう。まずは、はい、青いハンカチが中に入りました。はい、次は、はい、黄色いハンカチが中に入りましたね。はい、次は、はい、赤いハンカチを中に入りました。はい、最後は黒いハンカチ、はい、中へしっかり入れていただきました。はい、で中でよく混ぜます。まあ、混ざるかどうかは分かりませんが、では中に今 4色が入りました。で好きな色を1枚選ぶっていうのを取っていただきます、はい、でこうやって覗かないで上から手を入れて手サイクルで1枚だけ取って、でもし2つ上がってきたらどっちかを剥がしますか。はい、では見ないで手を入れていただきます。できるだけ1枚だけ触れてゆっくり開いてください。1枚取れました。取れましたね。はい、はい、選ばれました。さあもちろん赤を選んでおりますが、中はどこがこの、はい、でこの赤を使います。はい、4枚の中から10に選びました。恐れ入りますが、ここに箱も色が4種類あります。あの好きな色、今度は好きな色をおっしゃってください。何色がいいでしょう。黄色、はいはい、じゃあ黄色が選ばれました。ちょっと持っていってみましょう。はい、さあ今4枚の中から4色の中から10に選んだ1枚赤い主力で、10に選んだ4色の中から選んだ黄色い箱、これを使って今からすごいことをやってみます。実はこの箱、この黄色い箱の中に飛んでいくと。今からいきます。この感じです。いきます。1,2,3 さあ行きますから。
はい、
行きますね。今お願いします。ハンカチです。行きます。飛んでいったらそうです。行きます。 1,2,3 と消えてこの中に入りました。なんか重いのを感じました。
はい、
そーっと開けて、ゆっくり開けていただきました。
出ます。
ちゃんと飛び込んでました。
ありがとうございます。
いかがですか。
Back out.
Hello, Rebecca. I'd just like to try a little bit of an experiment with you, just to see if our minds can tune in together. What I'd like to do is to take the cards, put them behind your back, and take off the top half. Just cut the cards and give me the top half. Okay. Now, behind your back, I'd like you to take the top card of the pack, but I'm going to turn my back so I can't see what you're doing. And take the top pack, top card, and hold it. You got it? Okay. Could you give me the rest of the pack? Okay. You had the complete pack there to pick from, but before I came, I decided that we would tune together and you would select the card that I'd predicted. I predicted you would take that card. Which card did you take? Thank you.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I need four people and each of you to choose a card, please. David, would you say stop?
Stop.
This is your card. Look at it. Remember it. Have you got it? Go Don't on. Forget it.
I won't forget.
Okay. Derek, would you say stop, please?
Stop.
This is your card.
Yep.
Have you got it?
Got it.
Thank you. And Peter, say stop, please.
Stop.
This is your card. Must remember it.
Mm-hmm.
Arthur, say stop, please.
Stop.
And this is your card. Have you got it?
Yeah.
Four people. One prediction card with a different coloured back. Would you be amazed if I was to tell you that all four of you have chosen the same card?
Yeah.
Impossible.
Yeah.
For the first time, David, what was your card?
Five of hearts.
Yes, thank you. Derek, what was your card?
Eight of clubs.
That's the end of that. Never mind. It sometimes works, it sometimes doesn't. Peter, what was your card?
Four of spades.
Ooh, the four of spades. Thank goodness for that. Derek, your card?
Eight of clubs.
And the eight of clubs.
Five of hearts.
The five of hearts, maybe. The five of hearts. And was yours the ace of hearts, Arthur?
Yeah.
Thank you, well done. Thank you very much.
Simple effect using four dominoes. Two double fours, two double ones. Mm-hmm. Which would you prefer, Peter?
Double one.
Double one, I turn the double ones face down, place them on top of the double fours. I then reverse the order of them, putting the double ones over there and on the other side, the double
fours.
Correct. We then replace the double fours on the double ones. If you could hold your hand out, please, for me, Peter, and hold those tightly in your hand. I take this set and I turn them over once more. So you've got the double four back in this side and the double...
Double one.
No, you see, you weren't watching, sir. Would you like to open your hand? Two double ones. I will try and make it just that little bit easier for you by only using one set. If I place the double one on the double four, I turn them over and I take away this one, which is the double four, of course.
Double one.
Well, what are you left with?
Double four.
Turn it over, please. Now, you see, spots before the eyes. Now, of course, this effect is used by con men who cheat and occasionally magicians who bend the rules. And we always carry a spare domino to make sure it goes right. But if I take the spare away and I put the spare over there, what was the spare domino?
Double one.
Correct. And I take one of the dominoes, put it back on the other, turn them face up and face down, put your finger on that one. I cannot miscall that, the double one, because it's not in my pocket, it's on the table. But if I take that one away, what are you left with?
Double one.
Turn it over. That's the little bit I can't tell you about. Thank you.
Show Oliver how to do it, my dear. You see, Oliver, in this life, one thing counts. In the bank, large amounts. I'm afraid these don't grow on trees. You've got to pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. got to pick a pocket or two.
Large amounts don't grow on trees, you've got to pick a pocket or two.
Why should we break our backs stupidly paying tax? Better get some untaxed income, better pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two. Sing, boys!
Boys, if we all break our backs, better pick a pocket or two.
Charlie, take your hat off while you're in class. Robin Hood, what a crook, gave away all he took. Charity's fine, subscribe to mine, get out and pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
Robin Hood was far too good, you got to pick a pocket or two.
Watch the beat, boys. From Bill Sykes, he can whip what he likes.
I recall he started small,
he had to pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
We can be like old Bill Sykes if we pick a pocket or two.
Pay attention.
Dear old gent, passing by, something nice takes his eye. Everything's clear, I take the rear, get in and pick a pocket or two.
You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two, yes.
And the fear, attack the rear, get in and pick a pocket or two.
When I see someone rich, both my thumbs start to itch, only to find some peace of mind, I have to pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
Just to find some peace of mind,
you have to pick a pocket or two.
Hello and welcome. I'm going to introduce you to a special DVD which we've called The Legacy. And it's going to show you the easiest and best way to pick pockets. I'm also going to take you on a journey. And this journey started in 1937 when I saw my first professional pickpocket. He was called Giovanni. Now, Giovanni was an Italian. He spoke in broken English, which gave him a lot of comedy. Giovanni was only a very small act on the bills when he commenced. But he was appearing in cabaret in the West End of London. And in the audience on this particular evening was the then Prince of Wales. The Prince of Wales was wearing a diamond tie-pin. So Giovanni saw his opportunity. He went over to the Prince of Wales and he stole his tie-pin. The next day, every newspaper throughout the world had Giovanni steals from the Prince of Wales. He became a star overnight and he went to America and was working the top professional dates there. And of course, he was a star. At this time, I was performing a silent manipulative act. The big name of this period was Cardini. Now, Cardini, as we all know, did cards, cigarettes, and billiard balls. And every act of this period was trying to emulate Cardini. They couldn't, of course, but nevertheless, we were all doing this type of act. Just as when Channing Pollock came to this, to this country particularly, and performed his Dove Act. And so we were all on the bandwagon and performing Dove Acts. And so it was with Cardini. So at this period, I worked under the name of Sinclair. And this is a theatre bill of the Times. And there is my name in the Wines and Spirits of Sinclair. And so I continued to work until the outbreak of war, and then I was called up to ENSA, the entertainment branch of the forces, and I entertained troops of all nationalities. I used to enjoy it in France and Germany to entertain the Canadian and the American forces. Then in about 1945, I started to perform my pickpocket act. In fact, I've been doing my pickpocket act for so long now that the first words that Nelson Mandela said when he came out of prison was, "Is Mark Raffles still doing that pickpocket act?" I thought you might like to know. So at the time of the 30s and into the 40s, there were no information whatsoever on how to pick pockets. But there was a publication which came out in the late 40s, I think, and it was this book by Eddie Josephs called How to Pick Pockets. But there wasn't really any information in it that you could use in a professional act. So in 1980, I decided to publish my own book to reveal the methods and the ways to perform a pickpocket act for entertainment, that is. And it contained all the secrets and the methods that I had devised over the years. But I wanted to do this so that young performers of the future would be able to learn from this, hopefully evolve acts themselves and enjoy the pleasure which one can obtain from this kind of an act. It really is fun. Now, I'm going to show you a clip. It is an archive clip of a television show that I performed at the Collegiate Theatre in London for the BBC. I hope it gives you a better idea of what it's all about.
Lovely. And good evening. I'm going to commence in a peculiar kind of a way, because during the time that you came in,
You're all crowding. I don't know if you saw me or not. I was standing down there. And during that time, I have stolen two or three things from two gentlemen's coat pockets. There's a driving license here. I've got your driving license. I don't think it... And according to this, it belongs to a gentleman called Charles Brenton. If you can just come down to the stairs, I won't embarrass you at all. So do come down, Mr. Brenton. That is kind of you. I'm just going to, if you can stay there, so just a moment. Also, a gentleman just behind you, I've got your notebook, sir. A gentleman called Bone. It came from your inside coat, Mr. Bone. If you can be sure it's gone, if you can just come down and collect it, I won't embarrass you at all, sir. Thank you very much indeed. And if you can come up the stairs, sir, and I'm just going to return the belongings to you. Yes, sir, if you can just stand about here, sir. Thank you. All right, sir. And if you can stand just about there. And how kind of you two gentlemen to come along in this sporting way to help me. To lovely sport, thank you. The couple of belongings, sir, your driving license, it came from your inside coat pocket, sir. If you can return it into the inside coat and it won't get lost. And if you can stay there for me, thank you very much indeed. I'm just going to talk to this gentleman now. How are you, sir? All right. Your belongings, sir, it came from the inside coat, sir. If you can return it into the inside coat pocket, and I've also had here, I'm just explaining everything. I shall be a moment, sir. And it's here from this side, sir. I shall be just a moment. You don't mind, do you? But if you can return it, sir, into the inside coat pocket, and it won't get lost.
Thank you.
I hope you've all got the idea now. Lovely. That, can you be comfortable? Take a chair beside the table. Can I turn you around, sir? Thank you very much. Do sit down here, sir. That is kind of you. Fine. And can you be comfortable over here, sir? For I'm just going to slide you slightly over here if I can, and then they can all see and all hear. It was the only way I could get it. Yes. Well, we're going to perform together actually a trick. Do relax, sir. Do sit down. Lovely audience here. A trick performed about 2,000 years ago. These are comic pair of glasses. I'm deadly, sir, Mr. Bone. I can't see anything in your spare glasses. I do apologize about that. They're a strong pair, aren't they? You've got good eyes to see through them. I've just taken your cape, sir. Came from this coat. If you can return it, sir. That's not a lot, is it? If you can return it to your cape, sir, fine. Lovely. A trick performed, 2002. I'm dreadfully sorry, sir. I've got your glasses again. No, sir, out of the spare pair. He doesn't believe it. Doesn't believe it. If you can be sure they've gone, I don't take anything for keeps on it for lens. Oh, that's a nasty one. All right, thanks. Just a second. Fine. I just taken here, sir. If you can return it into the inside coat. Oh, I've got it again. It's just like Christmas on this side, I can tell you. A trick performed by a gentleman called the Galley Galley Man. And to perform a trick by the Galley Galley Man, do you object, sir, if you wear a Galley Galley Man's hat for me? No. That's just about your size, isn't it? Our jolly good friend over here, sir. Marvel. Lovely. Well, it's a small trick that's going to involve one, two, three small balls, and one, two, three, I call them large plant pots. Just to be sure they don't contain anything. Can you examine this one, sir? Hold it in your hand, be sure it's empty. Just the inside, sir, if you can. I didn't think I was going to get it. Marvelous, sir. If you can just examine these two, sir. Hold that one in the left hand. This one over here, sir, in the right hand. That's, oh dear. I don't know where to put it all. Fine. Like, if I can take those, so thank you. One, two, we're going to pop that one down there. And can you take the small ball into the right hand? Just close it up, hold it about there. And can you throw the small ball, a gentle throw from that position towards the cup? Now. They don't believe you, sir. Take up the cup and show them. There, I deserve some applause for that. Right.
that, we're going to try through the top of the cup. One. Again to join it. Two. And there's one. Two. One and three. How's that for size? All right. How did I go? I'm sorry, I've got your driving license again. And they came the inside coast. And if you can return it inside, and it's just, oh, that's a nice one, isn't it? My word, I think I was going to get that. How are you doing on that size? All right. I've got two or three things, sir. They all came your inside coat. Yeah, if you can return them, sir, into the inside coat pockets and they won't get lost. Now, that's a better one. That's a better one. Right. Well, they said, don't do too long. Can you just be sure, gentlemen, of the time for me, if you can? How's that one for time? Lovely. Thank you very much indeed. Well, there's an old Egyptian proverb, perhaps, which came first, a chicken or an egg? I do believe it was a chicken. Here we go. One, two, three, four. Well, how's that? Can you give these two gentlemen a wonderful round of applause? Very much. Do be careful going down. And coming along, sir, can you take a bow for me? Hold them up!
Russ, you've got a good memory. I'll just show you a few cards. Try and remember as many of them as you can.
Okay.
How many cards did I have in the first place?
Four.
Two, three, four. That's the first part, right. Could you name me the red eight, the suit of the red eight?
Eight of diamonds.
Eight of diamonds. Correct. Put that one down there. Could you name me the black eight?
Eight of spades.
Eight of spades. That's another one. You're doing very well. So if I turn my cards over back to back, could you tell me now if I've got the jacks, queens or kings?
Kings.
Correct. So I've got the kings, you have the
eights.
But if I flip my fingers like that, magically, now I have the eights, so you must now have the kings. Thank you.
Show. maybe I could read the instructions. And I just happened to have my old top hat I had when I was a kid. I've got a magic wand. Anyway, maybe the person I pick could act out the part and be the magician while I read. Well, let me see. I see a lot of hands up. Let me look around here. I'm looking around. I want to give somebody an opportunity here. How about, you know what? Of course, it would have to be a boy, because you know, girls cannot be magicians. What? Oh, they can? A girl can be a magician? Oh, well.
No.
No. Richard said no. Well, okay, I guess we could let a girl try, couldn't we? Well, how about that girl right there? Would you come up onto the stage? Give her a big round of applause. Here she comes. And what is your name? Let's have a different name. Give me a name. What do you want to be? Cheyenne.
Yeah.
Cheyenne. Cassidy Cheyenne. There may be a pattern here. Now, Cheyenne, you're going to play the part of the magician, okay? And I tell you what, I brought along, so you'll look really sharp, I brought along your tuxedo shirt front here. You're going to look like either a magician or a waitress at Shoney's. Okay. And then I brought along my old magician's cape. I'm going to put this on you. Face kind of towards me. I'm going to put this on you. Hold on, and I'm going to tie it with a bow knot, you know, so it can come off when the time comes, and you're going to be the magician. Now remember, she is the magician. She is not Zorro or the little vampire or any of those characters, okay? So there you go, and I kind of got you fixed there, and you know what? You need the magic wand. This is the magic wand right here, so I want you to take the... Oh, wait a minute. I need a black magic wand. Excuse me, I've got one right down here in my pocket. Here it is. This is the black one. Now, I want you to take this black magic wand, cast it. Cheyenne. You know what? I had a black one. This is a red one. Just a minute. Let me see if I can find a black one. I don't see. What's that? Oh, excuse me. There's a black one. Now, I want you to take this black one and put it. I'll tell you what. We'll use the red one. Okay. Here. Never mind. Now, hold that tight and get ready to wave it. Here's the hat. I tell you what, let me read the instructions first, okay? Here are the instructions. Look back here. It says here, when a professional magician produces a rabbit out of a hat, he first shows the hat empty, and then he waves the wand over the hat three times and pulls out handkerchiefs. Then he waves the magic wand over the hat three more times, and he pulls out the rabbit. Well, that sounds pretty simple. That's all we have to do. I'll put the book out of the way, and here is the hat. And Cheyenne, I'll put the hat right on your head. You've got the wand. Cheyenne, where'd you go? Where are you? Cheyenne, I can only see your teeth. Oh, look, she's got a smile with a hole in it. All right. Cheyenne, I'll tell you what, that hat, you know, this is my old hat. I had a bigger head than you when I was 12 years old. And you know what? That's probably a size 10. That's a 10-gallon hat. And she's got a 5-gallon head. That's what it is. So I'll tell you what, I'll just take it off. Wait a minute. I just remembered. I just got a kid-size hat. This is probably perfect for you. Look at that. This is a smaller size than that. This will probably fit right on your head without falling down over your nose, okay? Well, it's a top hat. That's what it's called. Face the front. I'm going to just put it right on top of your head, just like this. And you're going to look just great. Just great. Yep. Man, you are looking like a magic girl. Yep, just put your hand right there. You got the magic wand? Hold it, get ready. Now, Cheyenne, I want you to think rabbit. I want you to get rabbit at the top of your head. Picture a rabbit up in the top of your brain. I mean, no harebrained ideas here. I want you to just get the rabbit at the top or uppermost thoughts in your mind. Do you have a rabbit up there? You don't know. Think rabbit. Now, look, wave the magic wand over the hat three times, and let's see if you can do the magic. Go ahead. One, two, three. Reach in with the other hand and see if you can pull out something. Just pull out. Yeah, go ahead and pull out anything. Cheyenne, wait a minute. What is this? Cheyenne, what is this? Your laundry? Oh, I hope not. Wait a minute. That's not a rabbit. Wave the wand again. One, two. Wait a minute. Was that four or six or how many? It's supposed to be three. Take one of them back. Okay, thank you. Now, I'll put the wine away. I want you to reach into the hat and see if you can pull out a rabbit. Of course, she's not going to be able to pull out a rabbit because I was never able to pull out a rabbit. I used to try to pull out a rabbit, but I couldn't pull out a rabbit. I tried, to, you know what? One time I put the rabbit in the hat, but he wouldn't come out, so I couldn't pull out the rabbit. I was never able to pull out the... Oh, wait a minute. Wrong movie. Okay, blood count. Cheyenne, this is not a rabbit. This is a beanie bunny. Oh, isn't he cute, the beanie bunny. Look, Cheyenne, I think we better forget the rabbit, forget the hat. Would you come and stand right around here? We're going to do something different. We're going to do something. You know what, Cheyenne? People don't care about the rabbit anymore. You know that? They do not care about the rabbit. They want everything bigger. They want Jurassic Park. They want dinosaur magic. So, we're going to do dinosaur magic. I just happen to have here tonight a dinosaur egg. There's a picture of a dinosaur egg. Now, I want you to hold this in front of you, right up against your shirt, two hands. Come stand right over here, face the front. Now, don't move. I'm going to go and get the incubator, and we're going to warm up that egg, we're going to hatch it, and we're going to have the dinosaur out here, okay? Baby T-Rex, you can ride him around the parking lot. He'll step on people you don't like. Now just hold on here. I'm going to go back here, and I'm going to get the incubator and bring it right out right now. Yes, I am. Here it comes. The incubator. Right there. And I'm going to take this egg and put it right here, like this. There's the egg, the egg, the egg. Now, right here. Now, I tell you what, I want you to forget about the rabbit, okay? Would you take the rabbit off your mind? You've already done it? No, I want you to take the rabbit off your mind. Get the rabbit out of your head. You know that rabbit I said get at the top of your head? Get the rabbit off the top of your head. Can you do it? I think you could do it if you would just pull this off right here. Now, here's what I want you to do. Take a look inside of here. Are you okay?
Yeah, she scared me.
The rabbit scared her. He's only a big bunny. Okay. Here, I want you to take a look in there and see if you see anything. You see anything in there? Any hot dogs, hamburgers, Cokes, or Dr. Pepper? You see any airplanes, popcorns, peanuts, Cracker Jacks? Do you see anything in there? I do. I see your head in there. Your head is in there. Look, I'm going to put that right here. Cheyenne, put your hand right there and hold it down. Take your other hand and hold it up. I'm going to give you the great, big, giant magic wand. Here it is. Hold on to that right there. Just hold it right there. And now, when... Cheyenne, this is not Star Wars. Look at this here. Look, when I count to three, you hold on there, you wave that like that three times, and when I say three, you tap it right there once. So you go, one, two, three, tap. And when I count to three, I want all of you to shout these magic words. I want you to shout, every book is a magic book. Remember that, folks. Here we go. All together. One, two, three. Every book is a magic book. Wait a minute. Did you do it three times? You were only supposed to do it one time. Man, I don't know what kind of dinosaur will be coming out of here. Put your ear right there and see if you hear anything. Listen, do you hear anything? You do. Put your other ear there and see if you hear anything. Cheyenne, I want out. You hear that?
Yes.
Cheyenne, I want ice cream. You hear that?
Yes.
You know who said that? Me! Cheyenne, did you really hear anything in there? No. Cheyenne, do you know what that means? You know, it makes me kind of sad to hear you say you didn't really hear anything. You know what that means? It means there's nothing in there. It means it didn't work. It didn't work at all. You know, so I don't know what to say. It didn't work. I guess we should just quit and give up and forget it. Ah! Wait a minute, Cheyenne. That's a rabbit. That is a real live rabbit. Look at him. Here. Wait a minute here. I'll just make him right up here where he can stand and everybody can see him. I'll put him right there. This is my rabbit, Harry. Here, Cheyenne, you can reach up and rub him a little bit. He's losing some of his hair. He's shedding this time of the year. Just kind of rub on him a little bit. You know, I call him Harry because he's covered with fur. Anyway, Harry is a real live rabbit, and you know what? I think Cheyenne here, turn so they can see you, is a real live magic girl, and as I take her cape and tuxedo off, and she goes back to sit down, let's give Cheyenne here a great big round of applause. Thank you, Cheyenne.
One of my pet effects that up until now has been kept rather underground. In fact, it's only been revealed to people who've been at my lectures. This is the first time it's ever appeared on DVD. And for those of you who like to practice, it features a real killer diller knuckle buster of a slide. Bernice, we're going to do a card trick, but I've got a confession to make. I don't do this trick very often. I haven't done it for a while, and I've made a few notes to help me along the way. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Good. I think the first thing we have to have done is you have to pick a card. They all start like that. So would you just say stop for me?
Stop.
Okay, good. Now, I'll have a look which one you've stopped me. The Four of Clubs, that's a pretty good card, that, Bernice. Would you like to take the pen and just sign your name on the face of the card for me? Okay, that's great. That way you don't have to remember the card anymore. You just have to remember your name. Is that okay? Good. Now, we have to do the trick now. Let me just have a think for it. I do have to... Yes, there was something I had to do. I know what I had to do. I had to look at the first note. Yes, now the first note. Step one, lose the card. So I better do that. Yes, I'll lose the card. That's the good thing to do. I'll give him a couple of cuts here. Lose the card. Ah, yes, step two. Yes. Shuffle and cut. So let's give him a shuffle. And a cut. Step three. Oh, good. We've got to step three already. That's great. Well, we're doing well. Count five cards. That's one, two, three, four. step four. Stop. You never know. I could have gone past it. It's better to be safe than sorry, isn't it? So, well, I wonder if we've done it. There's a card there. Have a look at that card beneath.
It says use emergency card.
Use emergency card. I forgot about the emergency card. I put the emergency card in my wallet before I started the trick. Yes, in fact, I made a little note to myself to do it, actually. See, it says, place in wallet before the trick starts. See, the strange thing about this trick, Bernice, is how come this card, which I put in the wallet before the trick started, is actually your signed card?
Wow.
It's a strange thing.
Here's a little exclusive for my friends at Blackpool. I've never done it on DVD. I've featured in a few lectures, but it's a kind of thing that you need the right situation for. It's an old bit of business that goes way back. I've never heard anybody's name associated with it, but all you need is a piece of paper, fold it in half, tear it back and forth so that you don't get one side that's really clearly longer than the other. Tear it back and forth. You know, sometimes it's little bits of business like this that you get more mileage out of than an effect. Tear this. So now you've got this little V situation. Then roll this down. Roll one part of it down, the front part. Roll that down. And a little universal stick'em like this. And onto the paper, onto the picture, and you create the perfect illusion that the picture has been torn. Now, originally this was done with a brown paper bag on wallpaper, make it look like you've torn the wallpaper. A few applications of this. If you're in a really nice house, you tell the guy, oh, I was moving my table and accidentally I tore your wallpaper. I used to do it in all the hotel rooms I would stay in. It's particularly effective in museums if you're ever in that situation. I remember doing this the last time I was at Blackpool. I was in the lobby of the hotel with several of the guys, and a guy comes in to check into the hotel. They're sold out. As this guy turns around, the guy at the hotel, this guy leaves. I do this and stick it onto the wallpaper real quick and tell the owner, oh, look what this guy did when he was leaving. And the guy goes, why? Jumps over the thing, and we had to run out in the parking lot to catch the guy to keep him from beating the guy up. And they said, no, it's just a joke. Another time I was in Spain, and we're in a nice restaurant that had original paintings on the wall. We do this and put it on this painting, and it looks exactly like this painting has been ripped. Now the waitress notices this, but doesn't say anything for fear that it will reflect in her gratuity. But as she goes off, she gets the manager, brings the manager over. We see this and we take it off. Now they're looking around and they don't see anything. They leave. Then we put it back onto the wall. The next time the waitress came back, she can't believe it because it looked like it was like a very surreal effect. It was a transposition of the tear. It travels invisibly from the painting to the wall. But it's a wonderful bit of business that I get a lot of fun out of. You can even let the person see you doing it because they appreciate the illusion. And if you want, you can even later go on and create the impression that you've restored the painting. So it's a lot of fun. I hope you enjoy it.
Second.
Don't miss it. Nothing.
Nothing. Please, can you take out the seal? Nothing. Can you examine the bag?
There is no hole.
Nothing. No holes. No hole. Sure. Okay. And now, the bag. It's a present for you. And this seal is for my next show. Thank you very much.
My name's David Plant. I've just come back from Las Vegas. While I was there, I was walking down the strip. This guy came up to me and said, Dave, you're the guy that owes me $8. I said, no problem. I've got the $8. One, two, three, four. He said, Dave, it was $8, not four. I said, there's one. There's two. There's three. There's four. Five. There's six. There's seven. There's eight. He said, eight, Dave? You're counting $4 as eight. You're counting the front and the backs as eight. I said, no. He said, what's one and one? That's two. There's $2. Two and two plus one is five. There's five. He said, eight. There's five plus two plus one. There's your $8. I call that $10 interest. Thanks very much.
Hi, my name is Jeremy. I went to the opticians this morning and I was in for a bit of a surprise because the optician said to me, we're not using eye charts to test your eyes anymore. We're going to use playing cards. And I said, well, how does it work? He said, it's very simple. We're going to use the four queens from a deck of cards. I said, very good. I said, what do you do? He said, very simple. He said, you have to tell me which one of the four queens was face down. I said, none of them, they were all facing the right way. He said, well, your eyes are very bad, sir. Had you have been looking very carefully, you would have in fact noticed that the club had turned face down. I said, I didn't see that. He says, very funny. He says, some people actually think that the heart turns face down. He said, people who are colourblind get hearts confused with spades and think that the spades turn face down. And the remaining 10 or 15% of people actually think that it's the diamond that turns face down. He said, but I'll let you into a little secret. I said, what's that? He said, well, actually, you were right. All the cards are, in fact, facing the right way. I said, you're cheating me. He said, I'm not. He said, what colour were the backs of the cards? I said, they were red. Oh, he said, actually, you're colourblind, sir. Had you been looking very carefully, you would have, in fact, noticed that the backs of the cards are, in fact, all blue. I said, you're cheating. He said, I'm not. He said, what's your vision retention like? I said, I don't understand. He said, well, if I was to take this card and place it into my pocket, how many cards would I have left? Simple, you'd have three. I said, you're not watching very carefully, sir. Had you been watching, you would have in fact noticed that I do have in fact have the four queens. I said, no, you are cheating. He said, I'm not. He said, when did you last have your eyes tested? I said, about 4 years ago. He said, what did he use to test your eyes with? He said, well, in them charts on the wall with the little letters. Oh, he said, you mean one of them, sir? I said, yeah, that's right. He said, well, actually, your eyes are so bad, I think you need one, two, three, and I get my glasses next week. Thank you.
さあ、40ハンカチが出ました。こちらに持ってます赤い袋の中、これはもちろん 恐れ入りますが、1枚ずつこの袋の中に入れていただきますか。どれからでも結構です。1枚ずつ入れていきましょう。はい、まずは、はい、青いハンカチが中に入りました。はい、次は、はい、黄色いハンカチが中に入りました。ね、はい、次は、はい、赤いハンカチを中に入れました。はい、最後は、黒いハンカチ。はい、中へしっかり入れていただきました。はい、で中でよく混ぜます。まあ混ざるかどうかは分かりませんが、では中に今 4色入りました。で好きな色を1枚選ぶっていうのを取っていただきます。はい、でこうやって覗かないで上から手を入れて手サイクルで1枚だけ取って、でもし2つ上がってきたらどっちかを離します。どうしますか。はい、では見ないで手を入れていただきます。できるだけ1枚だけゆっくり開いてください。1枚取れます。当たりましたね。はい。はい、選ばれました。さあ、もちろん赤を選んでおりますが、中はこれがこの赤。はい。じゃこの赤を使います。はい、4枚の中から10に選びます。で、恐れ入りますが、ここに箱も色が4種類あります。あの好きな色、今度は好きな色をおっしゃってください。何色でしょう。黄色、はい、はい、じゃあ黄色が選ばれました。ちょっと持ってみましょう。さあ今4枚の中から4色の中から10に選んだ1枚赤い主力で、10に選んだ4色の中から選んだ黄色い箱、これを使って今からすごいことをやってみます。実はこの箱の黄色い箱の中に飛んでいくと。
Pickpocket. He was called Giovanni.Now, Giovanni was an Italian. He spoke in broken English, which gave him a lot of comedy. Giovanni was only a very small act on the bills when he commenced, but he was appearing in the in cabaret in the West End of London.And in the audience on this particular evening was the then Prince of Wales. The Prince of Wales was wearing a diamond tie-pin. So Giovanni saw his opportunity. He went over to the Prince of Wales and he stole his tie-pin. The next day, every newspaper throughout the world had Giovanni steals from the Prince of Wales. He became a star overnight and he went to America and was working the top professional dates there. And of course, he was a star. At this time, I was performing a silent manipulative act.The big name of this period was Cardini. Now, Cardini, as we all know, did cards, cigarettes, and billiard balls. And every act of this period was trying to emulate Cardini. They couldn't, of course, but nevertheless, we were all doing this type of act. Just as when Channing Pollock came to this, came to this country particularly, and performed his dove act. And so we were all on the bandwagon and performing dove acts. And so it was with Cardini. So at this period, I worked under the name of Sinclair. And this is a theatre bill of the Times, and there is my name in the wines and spirits
of Sinclair. And so I continued to work until the outbreak of war, and then I was called up to answer the entertainment branch of the forces.
I want out. You hear that?
Yes.
Cheyenne, I want ice cream. You hear that? You know who said that? Me! Cheyenne, did you really hear anything in there? No. Cheyenne, do you know what that means? You know, it makes me kind of sad to hear you say you didn't really hear anything. You know what that means? It means there's nothing in there. It means it didn't work. It didn't work at all. You know, so I don't know what to say. It didn't work. I guess we should just quit and give up and forget it. Ah! Wait a minute, Cheyenne. That's a rabbit. That is a real live rabbit. Look at him. Here. Wait a minute here. I'll just make him right up here where he can stand and everybody can see him. I'll put him right there. This is my rabbit, Harry. Here, Cheyenne, you can reach up and rub him a little bit. He's losing some of his hair. He's shedding this time of the year. Just kind of rub on him a little bit. You know, I call him Harry because he's covered with fur. Anyway, Harry is a real live rabbit. And you know what? I think Cheyenne here, turn so they can see you, is a real live magic girl. And as I take her cape and tuxedo off and she goes back to sit down, let's give Cheyenne here a great big round of applause.
One of my pet effects that up until now has been kept rather underground. In fact, it's only been revealed to people who've been at my lectures. This is the first time it's ever appeared on DVD. And for those of you who like to practice, it features a real killer diller knuckle buster of a slide. Bernice, we're going to do a card trick, but I've got a confession to make. I don't do this trick very often. I haven't done it for a while, and I've made a few notes to help me along the way. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Good. I think the first thing we have to have done is you have to pick a card. They all start like that. So would you just say stop for me?
Stop.
Okay, good. Now, I'll have a look which one you've stopped me. The Four of Clubs, that's a pretty good card, that, Bernice. Would you like to take the pen and just sign your name on the face of the card for me? Okay, that's great. That way you don't have to remember the card anymore. You just have to remember your name. Is that okay? Good. Now, we have to do the trick now. Let me just have a think for it. I do have to... Yes, there was something I had to do. I know what I had to do. I had to look at the first note. Yes, now the first note. Step one, lose the card. So I better do that. Yes, I'll lose the card. That's the good thing to do. I'll give him a couple of cuts here. Lose the card. Ah, yes, step two. Yes, shuffle and cut. So let's do my shuffle.
我々のうちの町でなりますと、ただ飛ぶだけで面白くて、これがまた帰ってくる。で、こういうのは、あ、ダメ。じゃあ、今度は本当に飛行します。シルクを見せます。行きます。ワン、ツー、スリーと、もちろん消えて、飛行します。もう一回じゃあ分かりました。ならここです。チーズの味ないかを開けますと、中からクリームのベーツが ボンドの新しいバージョンを見せます。ちょっとした変化技です。まあもちろん同じようにアンダージを中継するときます。消えたらなんとボンドの
I'm ready to flex. Don't know where I'm going, but I got it at best. Tonight I had a future on the internet test. Now I can like the first, so we will be the last. All I wanna do is everything that you ask. Don't you know I'm ready, get in the mood. Gonna be the fitness on the ready to pop. When I get grooving and I'm ready, I can't stop. Baby, when we gather, then the dot gone hop. Got you right, I'm feeling baby, straight to the top. Gotta make a hustle, better flip it and flop.
Over here we have a bird cage. The bird looks as though it's deceased, but don't worry about that. We have a small box. The bird cage goes into the box. Lid placed on, and now we start the transposition. Snap of the fingers, bird cage goes up in the air and travels from the tube over to the box. One empty tube. Let's have a look in the box. Seems to have arrived. There's the solid block, having travelled from there. Okay, now perhaps you'd like to know how this trick works. It actually uses a metal shell. The metal shell is the blue one, and it fits over the bird cage like so. By twisting the block slightly, the metal shell will stay in position. When the tube is placed over the top, what actually happens is there's a small recess in the bottom of the tube, and this metal shell lodges in the recess. So, as it's placed over, the metal shell is now lodged in the recess of the tube. When it's lifted off, stop. When it's lifted off, there is the metal shell in the end of the tube, and the bird cage has appeared. What about the box? Well, the box is not quite as innocent as it appears. The blue block is in one side of the box, but it's a double-ended box, and the bird cage does in fact have a sliding floor, so that when it's placed into the box, the floor moves up and allows the cage to go in. As you place it on the table, you simply reverse the ends, taking off the duplicate lid, and out comes your solid block. That's the Inzani Henley flyover cage. Hi, here's another piece from my collection. Essentially, this is one of only two ever made by Joseph Bland and Company in London. The idea is you open the front, open the lid, open the second lid, no mirrors, close the whole thing up again, close the door, close the lid. Strange thing happens.
That the first words that Nelson Mandela said when he came out of prison was, "Is Mark Raffles still doing that pickpocket act?" I thought you might like to know. So, at the time of the 30s and into the 40s, there were no information whatsoever on how to pick pockets. But there was a publication which came out in the late 40s, I think, and it was this book by Eddie Josephs called How to Pick Pockets. But there wasn't really any information in it that you could use in a professional act. So in 1980, I decided to publish my own book to reveal the methods and the ways to perform a pickpocket act for entertainment, that is. And it contained all the secrets and the methods that I had devised over the years. But I wanted to do this so that young performers of the future would be able to learn from this, hopefully evolve acts themselves and enjoy the pleasure which one can obtain from this kind of an act. It really is fun. Now, I'm going to show you a clip. It is an archived clip of a television show that I performed at the Collegiate Theatre in London for the BBC. I hope it gives you a better idea of what it's all about.
Lovely. And good evening. I'm going to commence in a peculiar kind of a way, because during the time that you came in, you're all crowding. I don't know if you saw me or not, I was standing down there. And during that time, I have stolen two or three things from two gentlemen's coat pockets. There's a driving license.
What is this, your laundry? Oh, I hope not. Wait a minute. That's not a rabbit. Wave the wand again. One, two, wait a minute. Was that four or six or how many? It's supposed to be three. Take one of them back. Okay, thank you. Now, I'll put the wine away. I want you to reach into the hat and see if you can pull out a rabbit. Of course, she's not going to be able to pull out a rabbit because I was never able to pull out a rabbit. I used to try to pull out a rabbit, but I couldn't pull out a rabbit. I tried, you know what? One time I put the rabbit in the hat, but he wouldn't come out, so I couldn't pull out the rabbit. I was never able to pull out the... Oh, wait a minute. Wrong movie. Okay, blood counter. Cheyenne, this is not a rabbit. This is a beanie bunny. Oh, isn't he cute, the beanie bunny. Look, Cheyenne, I think we better forget the rabbit, forget the hat. Would you come and stand right around here? We're going to do something different. We're going to do something. You know what, Cheyenne? People don't care about the rabbit anymore. You know that? They do not care about the rabbit. They want everything bigger. They want Jurassic Park. They want dinosaur magic. So, we're going to do dinosaur magic. I just happen to have here tonight a dinosaur egg. There's a picture of a dinosaur egg. Now, I want you to hold this in front of you, right up against your shirt, two hands. Come stand right over here. Face the front. Now, don't move. I'm going to go and get the incubator. And we're going to warm up that egg. We're going to hatch it. And we're going to have a dinosaur out here, okay? Baby T-Rex, you can ride him around the parking lot. He'll step on people you don't like. Now just hold on here. I'm going to go back here and I'm going to get the incubator and bring it right out right now. Yes, I am. Here it comes. The incubator right there. And I'm going to take this egg and put it right here like this. There's the egg. The egg, the egg. Now, right here. Now, I tell you what, I want you to forget about the rabbit, okay? Would you take the rabbit off your mind? You've already done it? No, I want you to take the rabbit off your mind. Get the rabbit out of your head. You know that rabbit I said get at the top of your head? Get the rabbit off the top of your head. Can you do it? I think you could do it if you would just pull this off right here. Now, here's what I want you to do. Take a look inside of here. Are you okay?
Yes, she's scared.
The rabbit scared her. He's only a big bunny. Okay.
Hello, Rebecca. I'd just like to try a little bit of an experiment with you, just to see if our minds can tune in together. What I'd like to do is to take the cards, put them behind your back, and take off the top half. Just cut the cards and give me the top half. Okay. Now, behind your back, I'd like you to take the top card of the pack, but I'm going to turn my back so I can't see what you're doing. And take the top pack, top card, and hold it. You got it? Okay. Could you give me the rest of the pack? Okay. You had the complete pack there to pick from, but before I came, I decided that we would tune together and you would select the card that I'd predicted. I predicted you would take that card. Which card did you take? Thank you.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I need four people and each of you to choose a card, please. David, would you say stop?
Stop.
This is your card. Look at it. Remember it. Have you got it? Go Don't on. Forget it.
I won't forget.
Okay, Derek, would you say stop, please?
Stop.
This is your card.
Yep.
Have you got it?
Got it.
Thank you. And Peter, say stop, please.
Stop.
This is your card. Must remember it.
Mm-hmm.
Arthur, say stop, please.
Stop.
And this is your card. Have you got it?
Yeah.
Four people. One prediction card with a different coloured back. Would you be amazed if I was to tell you that all four of you have chosen the same card?
Yeah.
Impossible.
Yeah.
For the first time, no, David, what was your card?
Five of hearts.
Yes, thank you. Derek, what was your card?
Eight of clubs.
That's the end of that. Never mind. It sometimes works, it sometimes doesn't. Peter, what was your card?
Four of spades.
Ooh, the four of spades. Thank goodness for that. Derek, your card?
Eight of clubs.
And the eight of clubs.
Five of hearts.
The five of hearts, maybe. The five of hearts. And was yours the ace of hearts, Arthur?
Yeah.
Thank you. Well done. Thank you very much.
Simple effect using four dominoes. Two double fours, two double ones. Mm-hmm. Which would you prefer, Peter?
Double one.
Double one. I turn the double ones face down, place them on top of the double fours. I then reverse the order of them, putting the double ones over there and on the other side, the double
fours.
Correct. We then replace the double fours on the double ones. If you could hold your hand out, please, for me, Peter, and hold those tightly in your hand. I take this set and I turn them over once more. So you've got the double four back in this side and the double...
Double one.
No, you see, you weren't watching, sir. Would you like to open your hand? Two double ones. I will try and make it just that little bit easier.
For we're going to use playing cards. And I said, well, how does it work? He said, it's very simple. We're going to use the four queens from a deck of cards. I said, very good. I said, what do you do? He said, very simple. He said, you have to tell me which one of the four queens was face down. I said, none of them. They were all facing the right way. He said, well, your eyes are very bad, sir. Had you have been looking very carefully, you would have in fact noticed that the club had turned face down. I said, I didn't see that. He says, very funny. He says, some people actually think that the heart turns face down. He says, people who are colourblind get hearts confused with spades and think that the spades turn face down. And the remaining 10 or 15% of people actually think that it's the diamond that turns face down. He said, but I'll let you into a little secret. I said, what's that? He said, well, actually, you were right. All the cards are in fact facing the right way. I said, you're cheating me. He said, I'm not. He said, what colour were the backs of the cards? I said, they were red. Oh, he said, actually, you're colourblind, sir. Had you been looking very carefully, you would have in fact noticed that the backs of the cards are in fact all blue. I said, you're cheating. He said, I'm not. He said, what's your vision retention like? I said, I don't understand. He said, well, if I was to take this card and place it into my pocket, how many cards would I have left? Simple, you'd have three. I said, you're not watching very carefully, sir. Had you been watching, you would have in fact noticed that I do have in fact have the four queens. I said, no, you are cheating. He said, I'm not. He said, when did you last have your eyes tested? I said, about 4 years ago. He said, what did he use to test your eyes with? He said, one of them charts on the wall with the little letters. Oh, he said, you mean one of them, sir? I said, yeah, that's right. He said, well, actually, your eyes are so bad, I think you need one, two, three, four. And I get my glasses next week. Thank you.
飛行のマジックを見せます。 赤い箱があります。中に黄色いシルクが1枚、もちろん赤が入ってます。さあこの1枚のシルクを手の中に入れます。そしてこれが消えてこの箱に飛んでいくという、こういうすごい飛行マジックです。いきます。はい、こうしました。でも我々宇都宮神社になりますと、ただ飛ぶだけで面白く、これがまた帰ってくる。で、こういうのはダメ。じゃあ今度は本当に飛行します。シルクを見せます。行きます。ワン。
Show Oliver how to do it, my dear. You see, Oliver, in this life, one thing counts. In the bank, large amounts. I'm afraid these don't grow on trees. You've got to pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
Large amounts.
Why should we break our backs stupidly paying tax? Better get some untaxed income. Better pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two. Sing, boys!
Why should we all break our backs? Better pick a pocket or two.
Charlie, take your hat off while you're in class. Robin Hood, what a crook, gave away all he took. Charity's fine, subscribe to mine. Get out and pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
Robin Hood was far too good. Get out and pick a pocket or two.
Watch the beat, boys. From Bill Sykes, he can whip what he likes.
I recall he started small.
He had to pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two. Yes.
We can be like old Bill Sykes if we pick a pocket or two.
Pay attention.
Dear old gent, passing by, something nice takes his eye. Everything's clear, I take the rear. Get in and pick a pocket or two.
You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two. Yes.
And the fear of...
No, sir, out of the spare pair. He doesn't believe it, doesn't believe. If you can be sure they've gone... I don't take anything for keeps on its lens. Oh, that's a nasty one. All right, thanks, just a second. Bye. Bye. I've just taken here, sir, if you can return it into the inside coat. Oh, I've got it again. It's just like Christmas on this side, I can tell you. A trick performed by a gentleman called the Galley Galley Man. And to perform a trick by the Galley Galley Man, do you object if you wear a Galley Galley Man's hat for me? No. Oh, that's just about your size, isn't it? Our jolly good friend over here, sir. Marvelous. Lovely. Well, it's a small trick that's going to involve one, two, three small balls, and one, two, three, I call them large plant pots. just to be sure they don't contain anything. Can you examine this one? So hold it in your hand, be sure it's empty. Just the inside, so if you can. I didn't think I was going to get it. Marvellous. If you can just examine these two, so hold that one in the left hand. This one over here, sir, in the right hand. That's, oh dear. I don't know where to put it all. Fine. Look, if I can take those, so say, one, two, we're going to pop that one down there. And can you take the small ball into the right hand? Just close it up, hold it about there. And can you throw the small ball, a gentle throw from that position towards the cup now? They don't believe you, sir. Take up the cup and show them. There, I deserve some applause for that. But... Right. Ah, we're going to try through the top of the cup. One. Again to join it. Two. And there's one. Two. One is three. How's that for size? All right. How did I go? I'm sorry, I've got your driving license again. And they came the inside coat. So if you can return it inside, and it's just, oh, that's a nice one, isn't it? My word, I didn't think I was going to get that. How are you doing on that size? All right. I've got two or three things, sir. They all came your inside coat. Yeah, if you can turn them, sir, into the inside coat pocket and they won't get lost. Now, that's a better one. That's a better one. Right. Well, they said, don't do too long. Can you just be sure, gentlemen, at the time? The small ball, a gentle throw from that position towards the cup. Now. They don't believe you, sir. Take up the cup and show them. There, I deserve some applause for that. But... Right. Ah, we're going to try through the top of the cup. One. Again to join it. Two. And there's one. Two. One is three. How's that for size? All right. How did I go? I'm sorry, I've got your driving license again. And they came the inside coat. So if you can return it inside, and it's just, oh, that's a nice one, isn't it? My word, I didn't think I was going to get that. How are you doing on that size? All right. I've got two or three things, sir. They all came your inside coat. Yeah, if you can turn them, sir, into the inside coat pocket and they won't get lost. Now, that's a better one. That's a better one. Right. Well, they said, don't do too long. Can you just be sure, gentlemen, at the time for me, if you can? How's that one for size? Lovely. Thank you very much indeed. Well, there's an old Egyptian proverb, perhaps, which came first, a chicken or an egg? I do believe it was a chicken. Here we go. One, two, three, four. Well... Can you give these two gentlemen a wonderful round of applause? Thank you very much. Do be careful going down. And coming along, sir, can you take a bow for me? Hold them up! Thank you.
hello and welcome. I'm going to introduce you to a special DVD which we've called The Legacy. And it's going to show you the easiest and best way to pick pockets. I'm also going to take you on a journey. And this journey started in 1937 when I saw my first professional pickpocket. He was called Giovanni. Now, Giovanni was an Italian. He spoke in broken English, which gave him a lot of comedy. Giovanni was only a very small act on the bills when he commenced, but he was appearing in cabaret in the West End of London. And in the audience on this particular evening was the then Prince of Wales. The Prince of Wales was wearing a diamond tie-pin. So Giovanni saw his opportunity. He went over to the Prince of Wales and he stole his tie-pin. The next day, every newspaper throughout the world had Giovanni steals from the Prince of Wales. He became a star overnight and he went to America and was working the top professional dates there. And of course, he was a star. At this time, I was performing a silent manipulative act. The big name of this period was Cardini. Now, Cardini, as we all know, did cards, cigarettes, and billiard balls. And every act of this period was trying to emulate Cardini. They couldn't, of course, but nevertheless, we were all doing this type of act. Just as when Channing Pollock came to this, came to this country particularly, and performed his Dove Act. And so we were all on the bandwagon and performing Dove Acts. And so it was.
The champagne is not me, but now I need a signature. Can you put your signature on the two of diamonds in big letters? Big, big letters, that's cool. That's, it's a pen, no more clues.
You want me to write on
your please,
card?
Yes, please, yeah. Put your phone number, thank you. Oh, just your name, that'd be cool. And space for this man's credit card numbers as well.
It's probably disappearing ink
S
there later.
A. Yeah.
R.
But do you want a question on sport instead? It's entirely your choice. Cool, thank you, sir, thank you. Now, sir, you get a glass of champagne for helping me. Thank you, but it gets better. Now, check this out. I'm going to squeeze it in the deck. When I do this, the card will visibly jump to the top of the deck. But you'll never see it happen. It happens that quick. This is such a cool trick. I'm going to take it here, squeeze it in, the little move like this, and it comes back to the top. Now, I'll do it again at fingertips. I'll do it again,
yeah,
real slow.
Incredible.
We do this.
Yes.
Little spin, squeeze it in, twice as quick, back to the top. But I'll do it again real slow. I'm going to teach you how
amazing.
This works. You see, when I do the funny move, I get eye contact, and you miss the move. So I do this, I sneak it from here over to here, but it doesn't explain how it gets over here. But it gets better than this. I'm going to make it travel all the way from here over to here and the blink of an eye. Sarah, can you just push the card in?
Look at his mouth.
Well, that was 45 seconds, world record. Well done you. Well, I have a fabulous souvenir. I got this from a man I met a few moments ago. You! I got this from this young man. I got his wallet. Fantastic. Special souvenir. This is for you. This is from Anne, who's holding a party today. This is for you. It's the bill for this afternoon. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Can you check it out? Sarah, you're going to love this. What a great trick. You're never going to believe it, Sarah. Such a cool trick. Trust me. The bill for this afternoon, very expensive. Well, I never. But you know what? It gets better than this. I'm going to show you. Can you hold on to the envelope, Sarah? I'm going to teach you how the trick works. In fact, you can see through the trick. Young man, can you just give me a hand? What's your name?
Matthew.
Are you married?
No.
Cool. Matthew, hold your hand out like this, Matthew. We do this. Can you just wave the envelope over the deck?
Sorry?
Just wave it over the deck. Watch. Just keep it here. Watch as we do this. And this. And this. Watch. Watch. Watch.
And then I was called up to answer the entertainment branch of the forces, and I entertained troops of all nationalities. I used to enjoy it in France and Germany to entertain the Canadian and the American forces. Then, in about 1945, I started to perform my pickpocket act. In fact, I've been doing my pickpocket act for so long now that the first words that Nelson Mandela said when he came out of prison was, "Is Mark Raffles still doing that pickpocket act?" I thought you might like to know. So, at the time of the 30s and into the 40s, there were no information whatsoever on how to pickpocket. But there was a publication which came out in the late 40s, I think, and it was this book by Eddie Josephs called How to Pickpocket. But there wasn't really any information in it that you could use in a professional act. So, in 1980, I decided to publish my own book to reveal the methods and the ways to perform a pickpocket act for entertainment, that is. And it contained all the secrets and the methods that I had devised over the years. But I wanted to do this so that young performers of the future would be able to learn from this, hopefully evolve acts themselves and enjoy the pleasure which one can obtain from this kind of an act. It really is fun. Now, I'm going to show you a clip. It is an archive clip of a...
Here's a little exclusive for my friends at Blackpool. I've never done it on DVD. I've featured in a few lectures, but it's a kind of thing that you need the right situation for. It's an old bit of business that goes way back. I've never heard anybody's name associated with it, but all you need is a piece of paper, fold it in half, tear it back and forth so that you don't get one side that's really clearly longer than the other. Tear it back and forth. You know, sometimes it's little bits of business like this that you get more mileage out of than an effect. Tear this. So now you've got this little V situation. Then roll this down. Roll one part of it down, the front part. Roll that down. And a little universal stick'em, like this. And onto the paper, onto the picture. And you create the perfect illusion that the picture has been torn. Now, originally this was done with a brown paper bag on wallpaper, make it look like you've torn the wallpaper. A few applications of this. If you're in a really nice house, you tell the guy, oh, I was moving my table and accidentally I tore your wallpaper. I used to do it in all the hotel rooms I would stay in. It's particularly effective in museums if you're ever in that situation. I remember doing this the last time I was at Blackpool. I was in the lobby of the hotel with several of the guys, and a guy comes in to check into the hotel. They're sold out. As this guy turns around, the guy at the hotel, this guy leaves. I do this and stick it onto the wallpaper real quick and tell the owner, oh, look what this guy did when he was leaving. And the guy goes, why? Jumps over the thing, and we had to run out in the parking lot to catch the guy to keep him from beating the guy up. And he said, no, it's just a joke. Another time I was in Spain, and we're in a nice restaurant that had original paintings on the wall. We do this and put it on this painting, and it looks exactly like this painting has been ripped. Now the waitress notices this, but doesn't say anything for fear that it will reflect in her gratuity. But as she goes off, she gets the manager, brings the manager over. We see this and we take it off. Now they're looking around and they don't see anything. They leave. Then we put it back onto the wall. The next time the waitress came back, she can't believe it because it looked like it was like a very surreal effect. It was a transposition of the tear. It travels invisibly.
Could read the instructions, and I just happen to have my old top hat I had when I was a kid. I've got a magic wand. Anyway, maybe the person I pick could act out the part and be the magician while I read. Well, let me see. I see a lot of hands up. Let me look around here. I'm looking around. I want to give somebody an opportunity here. How about, you know what? Of course, it would have to be a boy, because you know, girls cannot be magicians. Ooh. What? Oh, they can? A girl can be a magician? Oh, well.
No.
Richard said no. Well, okay. I guess we could let a girl try, couldn't we? Well, how about that girl right there? Would you come up onto the stage? Give her a big round of applause. Here she comes. And what is your name? Let's have a different name. Give me a name. What do you want to be? Cheyenne.
Yeah.
Cheyenne. Cassidy Cheyenne. There may be a pattern here. Now, Cheyenne, you're going to play the part of the magician, okay? And I tell you what, I brought along, so you'll look really sharp, I brought along your tuxedo shirt front here. You're going to look like either a magician or a waitress at Shoney's. Okay. And then I brought along my old magician's cape. I'm going to put this on you. Face kind of towards me. I'm going to put this on you. Hold on, and I'm going to tie it with a bow knot, you know, so it can come off when the time comes, and you're going to be the magician. Now remember, she is the magician. She is not Zorro or the little vampire or any of those characters, okay? So there you go. Kind of got you fixed there, and you know what? You need the magic wand.
The bird looks as though it's deceased, but don't worry about that. We have a small box. The bird's cage goes into the box. Lid placed on, and now we start the transposition. Snap of the fingers, bird cage goes up in the air and travels from the tube over to the box. One empty tube. Let's have a look in the box. Seems to have arrived. There's the solid block, having travelled from there. Okay, now perhaps you'd like to know how this trick works. It actually uses a metal shell. The metal shell is the blue one, and it fits over the bird cage like so. By twisting the block slightly, the metal shell will stay in position. When the tube is placed over the top, what actually happens is there's a small recess in the bottom of the tube, and this metal shell lodges in the recess. So, as it's placed over, the metal shell is now lodged in the recess of the tube. When it's lifted off, when it's lifted off, there is the metal shell in the end of the tube, and the bird cage has appeared. What about the box? Well, the box is not quite as innocent as it appears. The blue block is in one side of the box, but it's a double-ended box, and the bird cage does in fact have a sliding floor, so that when it's placed into the box, the floor moves up and allows the cage to go in. As you place it on the table, you simply reverse the ends, taking off the duplicate lid, and out comes your solid block. That's the Inzani Henley flyover cage. Hi, here's another piece from my collection. Essentially, this is one of only two ever made by Joseph Bland & Company in London. The idea is you open the front, open the lid, open the second lid, no mirrors, close the whole thing up again, close the door, close the lid, strange thing happens. You got a brick.
And around my arm. Okay. Please. Excellent. Right. One is okay.
You want
another one?
Okay.
Excellent. Look at this here, please. Okay. I have a red seal. How much time do you think I need for this seal inside the bag?
2 seconds.
2 seconds? I will do it in less than a second. Yeah. Don't miss it, nothing. Please, nothing. Please, can you take out the seal? Nothing. Can you examine the bag?
There is no hole.
Nothing. No holes. No hole. Sure. Okay. And now, the bag. This is a present for you. And this seal is for my next show. Thank you very much.
maybe I could read the instructions, and I just happen to have my old top hat I had when I was a kid. I've got a magic wand. Anyway, maybe the person I pick could act out the part and be the magician while I read. Well, let me see. I see a lot of hands up. Let me look around here. I'm looking around. I want to give somebody an opportunity here. How about, you know what? Of course, it would have to be a boy, because you know, girls cannot be magicians.
There is my name in the wines and spirits of Sinclair. And so I continued to work until the outbreak of war, and then I was called up to answer the entertainment branch of the forces, and I entertained troops of all nationalities. I used to enjoy it in France and Germany to entertain the Canadian and the American forces. Then, in about 1945, I started to perform my pickpocket act. In fact, I've been doing my pickpocket act for so long now that the first words that Nelson Mandela said when he came out of prison was, "Is Mark Raffles still doing that pickpocket act?" I thought you might like to know. So, at the time of the 30s and into the 40s, there were no information whatsoever on how to pickpocket. But there was a publication which came out in the late 40s, I think, and it was this book by Eddie Josephs called How to Pickpocket. But there wasn't really any information in it that you could use in a professional act. So, in 1980, I decided to publish my own book to reveal the methods and the ways to perform a pickpocket act for entertainment, that is. And it contained all the secrets and the methods that I had devised over the years. But I wanted to do this so that young performers of the future would be able to learn from this, hopefully evolve acts themselves and enjoy the pleasure which one can obtain from this kind.